Well, when I did this home theater, or I guess around Sunset, I made my living room here. I put the center speaker kind of above the TV, which works okay, but as I'm finding out, we need to turn up that center channel quite a bit to get dialogue and a lot of TV shows, movies we watch. So I'm going to basically build a center channel speaker out of a hardwood and run a wire. PVC conduit that I can run wire from the TV to my component cabinet here. And so once I do that, I'll just run the wire and then kind of run it down and then just unhook, not use that center channel, and maybe use that later on for a Atmos speaker probably or something like that. But anyway, so that's what I'm going to do here, is build my own center channel. Going to use Parts Express for the components, and if you're familiar with them, they have a Tritrex, they call it, speaker, and basically just using that and making one speaker out of the same. I'm going to add a ribbon tweeter versus the conical one they have in there. Anyway, we'll see what happens here. Boards here on the joiner planer to flatten one side, so I have a side to reference when I use a thickness planer. This board here is from a pallet, so I believe it's either oak or hickory. And the other stuff I'm using is those are the two sides, and then the part that for the back and the front of the speaker is going to be out of poplar. This wood here starts out of just a hair under three quarters of an inch, and so I don't have a lot to work with. Here I'm showing, there's the boards here. That's the oak after I'm done, and there's you see the poplar. That's a little bit softer wood and a little bit easier to work with, and that ends it's quite a bit thicker too as well. This is just a poplar. I don't show the hardwood going through, or the oak and the hickory going through. But it takes several passes down. And the nice thing about this joiner setup, planer setup, it's pretty quick to get all the boards the same thickness. I take these down to right at 3/4 inch, and I believe the half inch or the other boards. We're just a shot here under a half inch thick when I was done playing all the warps out of them. These here are pretty flat to start with, so I'm just basically taking them down to get the thickness I want. The other ones I stopped when I hit all the defects out of the wood. Okay, now that I have them all playing same thickness, that'll be probably cut out. Now it's time to take it back to the joiner, and we're gonna basically glue them up. So.
Okay. Because these are so, this is about 3/4 inch, so those should go together fine. Just dry fit and they fit pretty good right there. These here, I'm going to have to probably, they fit pretty good, but I'm gonna have to put a couple boards across here to keep from flexing or twisting, because that's pretty narrow. It's probably just a little bit under 1/2 inch, so that's what I'm next, glue them together.
So here I'm just gluing up these panels here, or boards to make the panels. They're going to be the 18 inches wide by 9 and 9 by 9. I got them pretty flat. I didn't have to do any more surface planing on it. They were, I mean, reasonably flat when they came out of this gluing process. The trick here was to not put a lot of side pressure on those clamps, that because that would tend to want to make them warp the whole board. And having the C clamps there and the board in the middle there also kept it pretty flat. But so I was quite surprised. Other than have to deal with a little bit of glue, that was about it with these. Because these were this pallet material, so you have a lot of nails, holes in it. You have wormholes, cracks, knots, and stuff like that. There's quite a bit of imperfections in it. It actually went all the way through the wood. So after I had them glued up, I went in, mixed up some 2-part epoxy here. Now I'm just filling the nail holes here. And the other thing too, with that 2-part epoxy, you have to have the backside, it got to be taped off. So you'll see me here taping out the backside. There's a few large holes I had to fill, and that's one small little crack, and all that epoxy will drain out of your hole you're trying to fix. So anyway, that's what I'm doing right here. So one idea here is to make it airtight for a speaker design. So here I'm cutting the lengths on the two side panel or two panels, front and back, 18 inches. This is that poplar, and I'm just using the Ray alarm saw here. Makes it pretty easy to cross cut. Kind of valuable tool I have, and kind of hard. You find one that if you find a good one like this, if you're a woodworker, I recommend buying one if you can fit it into your shop area. So these are the side panels. This is all the half inch hardwood here. I'm ripping these here at 9 inches. And out of these panels, I'll get all the top and bottom and side, the two side panels. So this is the poplar here, cutting that down to 9 inches as well. So now I'm starting the data process. So the front, that poplar piece that's going to have the speakers in it, it's going to be in a dado on all the four sides. So in here I'm just kind of starting that process here, I have to, I'm just using a single blade in my table saw here, so I have to cut, get the one edge cut, and then move over, get the other edge, and to make sure that I don't get it too big. And here I'm just taking a chisel to smooth it up in the inside there. So the process here, you got to kind of go slowly on that dado way I'm cutting it to make sure you don't overcut it. So. Now I'm cutting the, so the sides are all going to be on a dado too as well, just the width of the, panel, the two end panels that's going to, or side panels that's going to be on a dado as well, so I'm just cutting that now here. So it's kind of a slow process, you kind of get the one edge started, then you have to measure over and move the fence over and get the other side, and then once you get that done, you can slowly move that fence back over and to take out the remaining material, most of it, and then I would just clean it up with a sharp chisel. So. So now I'm starting the ends for the dado. That's basically this, the width of the of the wood, which is approximately just a hair under a half inch. So here I just start with that first width on the table on the fence to move it over. Now here I'm doing the I have a 9 degree of from front to back of to get a little difference in, you know, just to break up the box look. And so here I'm using the miter set at 9 degrees and up against, flush up against that table saw, and that's how I'm cutting these the dados on the ends there, or I guess it'd be on the bottom of the bottom and top of the box. So this went pretty fast with the miter. I could just get my first cut that I want, had to be straight against the table fence, and then from there on it really didn't matter as long as I didn't tip it too bad. Here I'm just cutting out the center for the center speaker. To tweeter, it's a planter style tweeter, and the woofers already cut those just didn't, for whatever reason, didn't have it to film it. This the poplar was pretty, that's why I chose that, because it's really easy to work with. It's almost like pine, but it's a little tighter grain, a little better look. It definitely takes stain better than pine does. Okay, I'm starting the glue up process. I'm gonna glue the front piece that holds the speakers in it, and that's got to say the dado on the four sides with two part epoxy, and then all the perimeter is going to be all those dados on the, basically just top, bottom, front, and side to side are gonna be all with Gorilla Glue, which is a polyurethane glue. And so one side of that needs to be wet with water. And then the other side, you put the polyurethane on, and then with pressure, it forms a pretty tight bond. But the problem there is it has to have pressure to hold it, for it to hold. Whereas the epoxy does not need pressure; it'll fill in gaps and harden up, and And so that's one difference. So if you see the Gorilla Glue foaming, that's actually bad. You want to eat it, you know, it should just foam. I mean, as long as it foams on the outside of your joint, you're fine. But if it would foam on the inside of your joint, it's not going to hold. So, and the other issue with that Gorilla Glue is that if it ever gets on your fingers, it's been almost impossible to get off, even with a good acetone or anyway a solvent. It won't come off. It, basically, your hands are black for a week or until it wears off. Now I'm starting to clamp this up now. By having that 9 degree of us basically slope or angle on that on these boards, it made it a little difficult to clamp. And if I were to do it again, I would definitely make some little blocks to make it easier to get those clamps tightened up. This was kind of a little more difficult than I was expecting, but anyway, I had to do it. I had to glue it all at once, so I had several clamps everywhere trying to get it tight. One thing about it, with the boards only being half inch thick, they flex a little bit easily on too much pressure, and I ended up kind of halfway through it figuring it out, and I threw the I should have put the back in it when I started, but I ended up doing it here to help it keep it all squared up. It came out pretty square. It wasn't great, but I mean, it's okay for what I'm trying to accomplish here. But yeah, definitely the next time I do something like this, I'll be a little more better planning, because I guess I have a little more experience, I guess, when trying to do the same box. Here, but I'm cutting the back part of the box there, and I had the table saw set at 9 degrees, and I'm just taking my miter on at 90 degrees and just slowly taking that off, that little part in the inside off, so when it would fit into the box here on either side was 9 degrees, so you had to have that cut, and this took a little bit of trial and error, but I got it pretty close on the first try. Now I'm starting the process of setting up the crossover here. And I basically just went into the Parts Express Trek Tricks crossover. There's a YouTube video, and mimic that pretty much to a T. It's just a little confusing on, you know, I was kind of confused on as far as negative, positive. There's negative, positive on those coils and those caps, but basically you decide which is negative and you decide which is positive. So that was kind of what I found out. So as far as all those caps and resistors, they all flow one way, so it doesn't matter which way how you orient them. But and also I didn't really understand how to solder very well, and I watched a couple of videos how to do it, and I figured out I was doing it all wrong. The idea here is you heat up the wire first, the two wires you're going to solder, and then you want that solder to impregnate into that both of those wires, and that's how you create the tight bond. So. And so basically I just used the hot glue and hold everything in place, and then laid it out, and then just did all of my connections here. So it has one common, it's a common ground, so that's all your, so from your receiver would be that'd be your negative, and then to the three speakers would all have the same ground. Or Yeah, the two speakers have the same ground. The way this is designed, it's two 4-ohm speakers. You run them in series, and that takes that 4-ohm up to 8 by cross wiring them. So you basically wire the first one like normal, black to black, red to red, and then to the second one, you go from that speaker black to red, and then red to the negative on the crossover. There, I just did the port. Now I'm just doing the terminals. Just drill a hole, two sides, screwed in tight. So pretty simple here. To finish this side, I just did 80 grit on all the sides, and then use the 80 grit to kind of put a nice round on all the corners. And once I had everything down pretty smooth, I went down to 220, and then just the same thing. And then I went from there. I went with a polyurethane natural Danish oil finish. But first, I use you'll see here a little bit. I use mineral spirits. Not the water-based, but the oil-based mineral spirits to basically clean it up and take off all the dust. And then right after that, I come in with the Danish oil polyurethane for finish, and then let that dry for a day. And then I think I put two coats of the polyurethane finish coat on it. So, and then between each coat, I would sand 220 and then reapply. So it came out really nice. So one trick you get here is by using the mineral spirits, as you show the where you have basically glue or the stain's not taken. So that's what I'm doing here. I found a couple spots, and then I had to use my chisel to take out that little spot of glue.
Here I'm just doing the leads to this for the amplifier, and then from the crossover to each speaker. And on the ends from this to hook up to the speaker, I just I put in little clamps or little connectors that'll connect to the speaker, so they can. If you ever had to remove a speaker, you can move it pretty easily. I didn't solder those. I mean, I soldered the ends to it, but not I didn't solder them together. So that's what I'm doing here. Pretty straightforward process. And then once I get this all finished up, then I just put it in the bottom of the box there and hold it in place with some hot glue. And then attach it to the posts on the inside. And then I also, you'll see me here, I grab some silicone, and I silicone the back panel, whereas I had a few gaps in there, so I close that up. And then if ever wanted to throw, like say, possibly throw insulation in there, it's possible. But I did do that in the first part of the when I first ran it, and basically had too much in there, and so I decided to take it out. So anyway, so I don't have any insulation inside the cabinet at this point.
So on the Tritrex speaker kit they have at Parts Express, so they use different tweeter. This is a planar ribbon style tweeter, and I use the same crossover. There's nothing different than what the one they designed for that speaker. So I can't tell you if that one would be better or not, or this one. This works well. It's a little bit more money. It was like, I don't know, $30 I think for it, but anyway, so that's the one difference between that Tritrex. Basically it's a tower speaker that I made into a center speaker, and this is 4.5-inch subwoofer. 4 ohms each, then you run them in parallel or in series to get them to 8 ohms. Anyway, but it's all a lot of it's hardwood pilot material glued together. In the back, so that I can take that apart. One thing about the port, when I first hooked this up, I played it, and it's like something was wrong. Like I did something wrong, because there was absolutely no bass coming from this, the way this was. And I would put that Infinity on, and I'm thinking I'd just spend all this money, do all this time, and I got something that sounds like crap, basically. So what I ended up doing, I called Parts Express, and I gave them the dimensions of the cabinet. And I told him what size of this was originally, about 4.5 inches by 2.75 inches. So it's a big port, and it's probably too big for this. Anyway, he said to cut that off at 2.5 inches for this design or this cavity size. And once I did that, put a hook drill back up, and it was like night and day. All of a sudden, I had this incredible bass coming out of this. So I learned my lesson there. You definitely need to, if you're going to build a speaker cabinet, you need to tune it. And this is 9 by 18. And I got a little bit of recess there. So the inside is probably, it's, what is it, 8 by 9 by 16. We'll probably get you real close, no matter what, far as the cubic inches. But so that's one thing to take into consideration if you want to build one of these. But let's do a little demo here and see what she sounds like. Turn me on. Like the desert, waiting for the rain. Like a school kid. Waiting for the spring. I'm just sitting here waiting for you to come on home and tell you're the only.